Hit it. Good morning, everyone. How you doing today? We'd like to welcome you here to the Temple of the Living God, and we'd like to welcome all the people on social media here with us as well. Thank you for joining us. We're grateful you're here. A song called White Bird.
Our speaker today is the always inspiring Reverend Mary Moore. And her message today is on living well. Before we hear from Carol and the Goodfellas, I'd like to share something I found on the interwebs attributed to a guy named Dave Willis. I don't know who he is, but he raises an interesting question, and I quote, "If God answered all your prayers, would the world look different or just your life?" In those quiet moments of today and during the week, I ask that you take some time to meditate on what your answer might be. Now, let's enjoy the musical stylings of Carol and the Goodfellas.
Thank you, Henry. Did you want to say something, Richard, your last song? We've got Lonnie Nichols on drums, but he's also singing today, so give Lonnie a big round of applause.
Hey, Lonnie!
Here we go. Your microphone.
You know, those little details can get you every time. Sorry about that. Okay, here we go. Sing along in the chorus. You're going to know it when you hear it. One. There's a reason for the sunshining sky. There's a reason. Oh, I'm feeling so high. Must be the season when that love light shines all around us. So let that feeling grab you deep inside. You're reeling where your love can't hide, and then go stealing through the moonlit night. Just let your love flow like a mountain stream, and let your love grow with the smallest of dreams, and let your love show, and you'll know what I mean. It's the season. Just let your love fly like a bird on a wing, and let your love bind you all living things, and let your love shine, and you'll know what that's the reason. There's a reason for the warm, sweet nights. There's a reason for the candle lights. Must be the season when those love lights shine all around us. So let that wonder take you deep in space, lay you under its loving embrace. Just feel the thunder as it warms your face. You can't hold back.
Just let your love flow like a mountain stream, and let your love grow with the smallest of dreams, and let your love show, and you'll know what I mean. It's the season. Just let your love fly like a bird on a wing, and let your love bind you all living things, and let your love shine, and you'll know what I mean. That's the reason. Just let your love flow like a mountain stream, and let your love grow with the smallest of dreams, and let your love show, and you'll know what I mean. It's the season. Let your love fly like a bird on a wing, and let your love bind you all living things, and let your love shine, and you'll know what I mean. That's the reason. That's the reason. That's the reason.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for the music. Thank you for the Living Well inspirational messages, Daniel. And thank you for inviting me. This morning, I do want to talk about living well. And I feel like I found an example of someone who life kind of gave lemons, and he made lemonade out of it. And sometimes I think we all feel like that, like our life is like, well, what do I do with this? What do I do with these talents and abilities that have been given to me? What do I do with that? So I hope that you find this very inspirational. I did. That's why I'm sharing it with you. His name was Gerald Jampolsky. I'm sure you've probably heard of him. He's a medical doctor and a psychiatrist. And I had heard of him. He even came to town, I believe, with Elizabeth Kubler-Ross quite a while ago. And for whatever reason, I didn't go see him and hear him speak. But in the meantime, I've become interested in his work. And so I did some research about who he was and what he gave to this planet while he was here. He was dyslexic, and that was quite a while ago. He was born in 1920, 24, something like that. And that was long before dyslexia was diagnosed as an illness. So he was bumping into things and fumbling around in life and felt very alone, very alone. He flunked kindergarten. In first grade, he raised his hand and gave the wrong answer, so he never raised his hand again because he felt so ashamed. And he was unable to read, write, or do any kind of memory work at all. Well, the kicker is, and we all have this in our life, we can all relate to this, he had two older brothers, and they were very bright and very accomplished. Ugh. There's always someone out there who's more accomplished than we are, right? So someone asked him how he got into the University of California. And he said, well, at that time, you could get into the university with a D minus. And he said, I had to take an English test to get in, which I flunked. And so then he was required to take an English course. It was very elementary, and he got a D minus minus. His professor said, Jampolsky, I don't know what you're going to do with your life, but don't ever plan on writing a book, okay? Well, as a result of that discouragement, he didn't write a book until he was age 50. And he ended up writing 20 books and sold 10 million copies. Yeah. I think it's so interesting to watch how life creates things like this. Because his abilities were slim in the beginning, and I'm a substitute teacher, so I go into these classrooms, and some days I spend time with people who have special abilities and so forth, and I always know that within each one of us on this planet, there is a genius inside of us. If we could just access that and bring that out, there's something that we can do that perhaps no one else can do as well. And so I see that in these young children that I've worked with. And so I see how life honed his skills so that he was so simple. And when you read his books, they're so simple. There's a lot of space on the page. And yet the words are so profound. And the people who have been studying his work, I think he really started his work in 1970, so that would make 50 years that people have been studying his work. Around the globe, it's like in 40 countries. They're so touched by that, and it's changed their lives so much by the work that he has done on this planet. Well, his grades were so poor to get into medical school, but he did get in. And something you all may not know is once you get into medical school, they invest so much money in your education, they don't want you to flunk out. So if you can get in, you got a pretty clear path. So he did get in, and when he graduated, he was on probation. But he graduated. He met a doctor who was kind of like an angel in his life who thought he would make a really good doctor. That Dr. Gerald Jampolsky would make a really good doctor. And he was in his internship. Jerry Jampolsky had no idea, but they were grading him in his internship. And he came out on top of all of them. Why was that? Because he had a wonderful bedside manner, very gracious man. And this is the genius part I was just talking about. He would diagnose people through his intuition. That was his genius. Now, the others had all the data from the books, but he had the genius. He just knew by sitting with this person what they needed to be treated for and so forth. So he ended leaving his internship on top as number one intern. Yes. So he came in contact. He went through alcoholism. He went through a divorce, went through a lot of trials and tribulations, as oftentimes people do when they're meant to do something very extraordinary for this planet. So he comes in contact with A Course in Miracles, and he slimmed it down, which would make perfect sense for someone who had his abilities, because one of the criticisms I've heard about The Course in Miracles is that it's very wordy. And when you read The Course in Miracles, you read it this way, and then they'll say the exact opposite. And people are sitting there going, what are they saying? They just said the exact opposite. My personal feeling is, and people with whom I've talked about this with, we all agree that it seems like perhaps they're trying to balance the right and left hemisphere of the brain by coming this way and this way. But anyway, Gerald Jampolsky did a simplified version of The Course in Miracles. And so for all those who have struggled with it, this could be your answer. He wrote the book with the 12 principles, Love is Letting Go of Fear, in 1970. And he spent the next 50 years of his life traveling around the world, wherever he was invited, talking about these 12 principles. So I'm going to talk with you about them a little bit this morning. When you are in a group and they read these 12 principles, it just sets the stage for everything else. So forget all the words, forget everything. It's just very simple, and almost everyone has something about the basic principle of the Golden Rule, or it's about love, or it's about peace, and that is the theme down through these 12 principles. The first principle is, the essence of our being is love. A woman from Australia said that the opportunity we have is to practice being an unconditional love giver. Ooh. I said, well, what is that? She said, well, it's like if you're in a room, yes, I'll receive it right now. You all can send me love. Or you can send someone love next to you if you feel they're in discomfort or they're speaking in the group and they're having a hard time. She said sometimes she gets phone calls and someone will say, I'm speaking somewhere. Would you come and just be in the audience with me? Because they know the power, and she is very loving. She's practiced this for like 22 years. She is very loving in sending her love. She was telling about a situation in Australia where they went to these nursing homes, and they targeted mainly people who had dementia or Alzheimer's. Their families were pretty much stopped seeing them because they said, well, when I go in, they don't even know who I am. And so it was that kind of situation. Well, these people would be a part of an attitudinal healing group, and they would leave the group and go into the nursing home and sit with this person. Sometimes they took the person out just to sit and look at the ducks. And so they would just be sitting there. But we know how powerful our energy system is, right? So even though we're just sitting next to them and we're not saying anything, just by guiding them out, helping them to sit down, just maybe talking about the ducks a little bit, or saying nothing at all, they noticed something. These people were very different in their interactions in this residential center than they had been before these attitudinal healing people came in. Very different. And family members who stopped by noticed that they were more alert and more interactive just because of spending about an hour with them once a week. That's all. Wow, that's huge. So the essence of everything, the essence of our being is love. Number two attitudinal healing principle is health is inner peace. When Reverend Jack Barker, who was, he's now on the other side of life, but he was my first unity teacher, and he always said he wanted us to be healed in consciousness because it did not matter at that point whether the body stayed here or not. Don't worry about that. Sometimes the ravages of whatever the illness is beyond where perhaps that could come back. So he said, I want you to be healed in consciousness so that wherever you go from here, you never have to have that experience again. Now we have Reverend Joe Dispenza coming along, and he says, I don't care if you have stage 4 cancer. If you touch into this allness, this consciousness that Jack Barker was talking about, you can go in remission. He said, I've had plenty of people in stage 4 cancer, and they go in remission. So you see, as more of us gather to have conversations about this, there are more opportunities for all of us to demonstrate this in our life. It literally creates as they say, when enough people believe, it raises the consciousness of the entire planet, when enough of us believe. So the next one is number three, giving and receiving are the same. My daughter-in-law is from Colombia, South America, and she studied 12 years of English. It was British English. She could read, she could write it, but when she met me, she could not speak it. So we just kept working with that, and my son would interpret and so on. She came one day for 2-week vacation here, and she had been working a lot on her English, trying to understand it. And between the time I last saw her and the time she came here, someone told me that in the English language, there are 500,000 words. 500,000 words. And in the Spanish language, there's 30,000 words. 30,000 words. So I'm putting on my thinking cap, and I'm thinking, if I say Dick and Jane ran up the hill and I say it very slowly, there's a likelihood if I speak very simply, like I like or I want, that she would be able to understand that. So she comes for a visit. And she and I have an interaction, and I begin speaking very slowly like this. And I begin speaking very simply. What's that take away from me? I'm giving and I'm receiving, right? So I go and I speak one Sunday morning. There's about 25 people there, and I said, listen, my daughter-in-law is here, and she can't understand English, but if I speak very slowly, she can understand. So this morning, I'm going to speak very slowly and very simply on purpose so that she can feel included in our group. Well, they were people like us. All you need to do is propose something, and 30 people were on board with me, right? So what else did she get from that? The benefit of 30 people, of thought atmosphere, going out, wanting her to get that message, whatever I was giving. So she did. For the first time, she was able to receive a message. And it was 20 or 30 minutes. And she said when it was over, I understood everything. I understood everything. So when she left the United States, she told her husband, my son, she said, Mary was the only person that spoke English that I could understand. That's where giving is receiving. I got a lot out of just being able to connect with my daughter-in-law. Giving and receiving are the same. We can let go of the past and of the future. Lao Tzu says, when we think about the past, we oftentimes have regret and grief because we're looking backwards at what we did. Oh, I'm so stupid. All this inner chatter, right? When we look to the future, why do we have an anxiety? Because we don't know what the future is. When we're here in the present moment, what do we have? We have peace. Because in each moment, we can find a way to deal with that one moment. so powerful and so true. So that was number four. Number five is now is the only time there is. I saw a cute little YouTube the other day, and it was Ram Dass who wrote Be Here Now, and Eckhart Tolle on stage, and he wrote The Power of Now, I believe. And the person who introduced them said, there's a whole lot of nowness going on right here. Whole lot of nowness. Well, now is only the only time there is. We can learn to love ourselves. That was a big one for Louise Hay, and it was the essence and the substance of her teaching, that if we can love ourselves, that the whole reason we incarnated and came here to this planet is to learn to love ourselves. That if we could do that, then everything else would be fine. If we could really learn to love ourselves. And she had all these exercises like look in the mirror and say, I love you, Louise. Call yourself by name. I love you, Louise. And many, many other things about ways to love yourself. So that was the essence and the teaching of her work. You can become love finders rather than fault finders. Do you all realize that you actually change the neurons in your, this is according to epigenetics and neuroplasticity. You can actually change your brain through loving people. You actually change your brain. The synapses and the whole structure of the neuronic activity there totally shifts and changes completely. And you can see more the more that you do that. So it behooves you and me to love more because it actually changes our brain. We can choose and direct ourselves to be peaceful inside regardless of what is happening outside. Boy, that's a big one. Can you be peaceful regardless of what's happening out here? What's happening out here is just temporary data. What's happening in here is our eternal journey. I firmly believe that when we drop these bodies and we go to the other side, that what we are inside is what we take with us. As I've said before up here, you notice that there's no hearse with a U-Haul behind it. You know? There's no hearse with a U-Haul long behind it, of all of our stuff, you know? We don't take stuff with us. Just the love, you got it. So whatever's happening in here is what we take with us. And wherever we get to the other side in the next activity, because it's just another plane of activity, just like this. So wherever we end up, it's because of who and what we are. We are students and teachers to each other. There are many hierarchical teachings, and one of which is Madame Blavatsky and the tradition that has been taught here through Theosophy and of David Hawkins. He has that hierarchy. And the point simply is that he always said that no matter where you are on the scale of life, you're not better than. You know, you need people to come in and do other things for you. And so leave them where they are. But the idea is that as you are above someone, you help to pull them up. And that's true of all of us. It's not just some great guru and great teacher. We all are teachers, and we are all students to someone else. Because they may have a piece that we don't have. And we want to see that. Of course we want to see that. That expands our consciousness. And really, you know, I've always thought of God as a diamond or the source of life as a diamond. And we just all see these little facets on the diamond. We see it, all the different sides. And so it's really fun to see how someone else sees things. It's not to be challenged. It's not to be like they're bad for looking at it that way. It's just a different facet of the diamond. We can focus on the whole of life rather than its fragments. So we would be the fragments, and the divine would be the whole of life. I went to Europe and stayed for 2 months. And let me back up. So I was 15 years old, sitting in an English class, and a guest speaker came in, and we had an assignment to do as a result of that. I got paper that was like white paper with no lines on it. We had to write an essay, and I knew how to write cursive. So I was writing cursive, and I had mastered this, and it was like an art form, but I had never thought of it that way. And he called me up to the front of the room, and he said, "Your cursive writing is so beautiful." And it was written straight across the page with no... He said, "Your cursive writing is so beautiful. I would love to frame this. It's an art form." I'd never thought about that at 15 years of age. So anyway, I go to Europe and I write them a note in cursive. And they can't read it when I send it to them. Now, what is the purpose of speaking or writing? It's about connection. It's about love to love, heart to heart, you know, expressing. So there went my artistic abilities in that area. I said, okay, if I can't connect with them and they couldn't read it, and I found that as feedback later on, I'm going to start printing. Sometimes people say, "Oh, your writing's so pretty." Well, it's just neat, but I don't think it's really pretty because I write in like printing now, and I sometimes link it together. But anyway, but what is more important? I think this is so typical of sometimes what we do. We're so attached to some art form of how we express ourselves, and we don't let it go to see what else could emerge within us. Just let it go. There's plenty of artistic ways to express ourselves on this planet, and we need it. And now, you know, cursive is not even taught in these schools. Everybody prints. And I substitute teach, and when these kids come up, and they have M... more, I'm just giving you that as an example. They have their first initial and their last name, and you can hardly read it. If I have a chance to talk to them, I ask them, what is your purpose in handing in a paper like that? There's no connection there. Do you think you're going to get credit for that paper? I can't even read it. They don't like me. Love is eternal. Love is eternal, number 11. Love is eternal. So, what about that? Edwin Schrödinger, who was considered to be the father of quantum physics, or one of the fathers, because I think several of them converged at the same time. But anyway, he said that there is a singularity. There is a oneness of one mind and one consciousness and one life. And Stephen Greer was saying, if we could really get that concept, there would be no more war. We couldn't kill each other if we see each other as one. There would be no more war. I was in a group one morning, and I caused a big stir because I said that we should pray for Putin. Oh my gosh. So anyway, people said, he's going to darkness. Well, let me tell you something. He's still from the same source. And if he is so estranged from the source of life that he can make some of the choices he's making, he needs some prayer. Pray for him. I do all the time. I pray for him all the time and all those around him. I want to be in that consciousness where I'm sending him love, even if it's deflected or whatever, sending him love. I want everybody on the planet to remember who they are. All right. We can always see others as loving. So way back here, it was number 6, we can learn to love others. And love is eternal, and we can always see others as loving. Well, if you love yourself, you can't help but see others as loving. I mean, it's impossible. Last night, I was talking on the phone to someone. I actually met her here. She went to the Midwest and created a new life for herself. And she said, what are you doing? I said, I'm going to speak at the temple where I met you. and I'm going there to speak tomorrow morning. She said, I am so glad that temple existed. I wouldn't be doing anything I'm doing right now if it wasn't for that temple. And she had just told me a long lineage of stories that were very inspirational about people who had been in alcohol rehabilitation centers, and she's out there doing that. And people who could not be reached, she was able to reach. I'm telling you, you all are powerful. You're going around the world. So this is living well, is being able to remember principles like this and living it as fully as we can, because nobody's perfect. We're in this dimension. So don't judge yourself so hard. We are in this dimension, and so it's difficult to be doing what we're doing. We are pioneers. Daniel Boone came across. Columbus came across, different people came across, right? We are pioneers in consciousness. And it's difficult. Cut yourself some slack. I got a fun story for you. And since the Course in Miracles is based on Jesus' teachings, I thought it was appropriate. It's about a bike, a tandem bike. And Jesus is on the bike, and so are each one of us, okay? So, so just stay with me as I share this with you. Sorry. The title of it is My Bicycle Ride Through Life. At first, I saw God as my observer, my judge, keeping track of the things I did wrong, so as to know whether I merited heaven or hell when I die. He was out there sort of like a president. I recognized his picture when I saw it. But I really didn't know him. But later on, when I met Christ, it seemed as though life were rather like a bike ride, but it was a tandem bike. And I noticed that Christ was in the back helping me pedal. I don't know just when it was that he suggested we change places, but life has not been the same since. When I was in control, I knew the way. It was rather boring, but predictable. It was the shortest distance between two points. But when he took the lead, he knew delightful long cuts up mountains and through rocky places at breakneck speeds. It was all I could do to hang on. Even though it looked like madness, he said, just pedal. I worried and was anxious and asked, where are you taking me? He laughed and didn't answer, and I started to learn to trust. I forgot my boring life, and I entered into the adventure when I'd say, I'm scared, he'd lean back, touch my hand. He took me to people with gifts that I needed, gifts of healing, acceptance, and joy. They gave me gifts to take on my journey, my Lord's and mine. And we were off again. And he said, give the gifts away. They're extra baggage, too much weight. So I did to the people we met along the way. And I found out that in giving, I received. And still, our burden was light. I did not trust him at first. In control of my life? I thought he'd wreck it. But he knows bike secrets. Knows how to make bend to take sharp corners, knows how to jump to clear high rocks, knows how to fly to shorten scary passages. And I'm learning to shut up and just pedal in the strangest places. I'm beginning to enjoy the view and the cool breeze on my face with my delightful constant companion, Jesus Christ. And when I'm sure I just can't do it anymore, he smiles and he says, just pedal.
Thank you, Reverend Mary. We are so blessed to have you here. We are so very grateful. Thank you for sharing. What a breath of fresh air, yes. So we've come to the portion of the service where we move into our tithes and offerings. So we invite you to take your tithes and your gifts in your hands and bless them. Perhaps just bring them to your heart and just give thanks. I ask the ushers to come forth. Thank you. And let us pray. Infinite radiant source of life, we give thanks for this wonderful opportunity to be able to share. We give thanks for the presence of love here. We give thanks for the opportunity to be able to go out into the world, to be able to share the love that we are. And we know that as we give in this moment, we acknowledge that divine love moving through each and every one of us blesses and multiplies all that we have, all that we give, and all that we receive. And for this, we are truly grateful. And so it is. Amen. Amen. And now, as a reminder, for those of you perhaps who had seen out there in the lobby, there were a couple of cards there for Reverend Zemke. Please, if you haven't done so already, we invite you to sign those for his birthday. Okay. And there are refreshments also in the lobby that will be served today, so enjoy some of those. And now let us end the service with our final song with Carol and the Goodfellas.
We're going to sing We Are Family. And this is the family we get to choose. The one we're born into is not always our favorite family. So I just want to thank all of you for being loving, as Mary was saying. This is a loving place. I love all of you. I feel the love you give us. And I am heading back north sometime in the next week or so. And I just want to say adieu. And I will see you all next season when I get back. Thank you all.
Just begun to get our share of this world's delights. High hopes we have for the future and our goals in sight. We don't get depressed. Well, here's what we call our golden rule. Have faith in you and the things you do.
Family.
your neighbors, look at the person next to you, tell them that you love them.
Yeah.
Okay, here we go. One, two, three, go.
We are family.
Hey, 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 now.
I got all my sisters with me. We are family. Get up, everybody, and sing. We are family. I got all my sisters with me. We are family. Get up, everybody, and sing.
Get up, everybody, and sing.
Have a wonderful afternoon. We appreciate all of you so much.